is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. He is Lord. Savior's love through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
Good morning. I want to welcome you to worship this morning. It is a pleasure to have you with us. I invite you to join with me in our opening prayer. Holy and gracious God, today we continue to hear about the kingdom of God all around us. We know that you accept us just the way we are, with our doubts, with our fears, with our uncertainties, all that we are. You receive into your care. Bless us this day as we come and offer you our worship and praise. Give us your hope, and may we experience your kingdom daily in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Today's gospel reading is from the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 13, beginning at verse 47. Jesus says, "The kingdom of heaven is like what happens when a net is thrown into a lake and catches all kinds of fish. When the net is full, it is dragged to the shore, and the fishermen sit down to separate the fish. They keep the good ones, but throw the bad ones away. That is how it will be at the end of the time. Angels will come and separate the evil people from the ones who have done right. Then those evil people will be thrown into a flaming furnace, where they will cry and grit teeth in pain." Jesus asked his disciples if they understood all these things. They said, "Yes, we do." So he told them, "Every student of the scripture who becomes a disciple in the kingdom of heaven is like someone who brings out new and old treasures from the storeroom." Here ends the gospel of our Lord.
Good morning. So I'm getting ready to hopefully do some fishing the next couple weeks. So I've been packing up my fishing bag. I got some lures here that I use, and some more lures. I got some artificial worms that are always helpful. I made sure I have my pole. I made sure my reel works nice and it's nice and smooth. Got my fishing hat. So I think I'm ready to go fishing, which kind of reminds me of this Sunday's text, where at the end of Matthew 13, Jesus tells us about the kingdom of God is like a fishing net. Fishing. For most of us, when we go fishing, we use tackle, we use a reel, we catch one fish at a time. But this image that Jesus is using is far different than what we normally do. And even in Jesus' days, there were times when they would just use a line and a hook and catch one fish at a time. There were other times that they used these smaller nets that would catch a good size amount of fish, but not huge. But this morning, what Jesus is referring to when he refers to the net is a special kind of net. This kind of net could be a half a mile long. It grabs everything that it comes in contact with. Live fish, dead fish, weeds, junk, you name it, it grabs it. And it grabs everything. That part of the water is completely engulfed in the net. That's what Jesus is talking about this morning, when the kingdom of God is like a net that gathers all the fish. And we see that by how when they bring it ashore, there's everything in there. And the angels are in charge of separating the fish, those that are kept and those that are discarded. There's important things to remember about this last parable about the kingdom of God is like. Again, this is the last one in a series that we have been looking at with chapter 13 in Matthew. Again, in today's parable, Jesus is reminding us of how the kingdom of God gathers everything. Over and over again, Jesus is reminding us and the disciples that the kingdom of God covers everywhere. That everything in its path is brought into the kingdom of God. There are no fish left behind. All are gathered. And it reminds us that God's kingdom is working everywhere. And God's kingdom is engulfing everyone and everything in this universe in which we live. That's an important part to remember as we think about the kingdom of God. And then it turns to the separation, which oftentimes is a place that we often want to talk about. Finally, the good fish and the bad fish are separated. Finally, there's judgment. What are we to make of that? What makes a good fish and what makes a bad fish? Some say righteous and some say wicked. What is causing the angels to separate these two fish? Well, first we're reminded that the angels only do it by the instruction and authority of the fishermen, of God. We are reminded that the fish don't determine who's good and who's bad. So first of all, we don't have to worry about it. It's not our job. It's not our responsibility. We're the fish. The angels have been given the instruction on how to separate what is righteous and what is wicked. But if we look at Scripture, we begin to see what Jesus is implying when he says those who are righteous and those who are wicked. If you think about other parables where the ending is this sense of judgment, we begin to realize what makes the judgment is not even God, it's the individual themselves. Think about the story of the prodigal son, the loving father, the lost son, the older son, whatever you want to call it. What separates the older son from his father and from the party for his younger brother who has returned, the one who was lost and now has been found, is not that the father did not include him. It's that the older son refused to be included. Remember how the story ends? The older son says to the father, "Your son has returned. You've never done this for me." And the father invites the older son, "Come, join the party. The one that was lost has been found. Your son, your brother has returned." And we're left with that. We left with the older son still being outside the party, and we're not sure if he ever is willing to go in. Oh, well, his desire for the younger son to be judged keep him from celebrating the party. We have the story of where the king invites all the people to come to his son's wedding, and all the guests refuse. And the king goes, go to all the corners of the kingdom, invite everyone. And you have all these people coming into the party. They're all getting clothes on, the wedding, appropriate wedding attire, and they're all celebrating. And one person comes in and refuses to wear the clothes that the king provides. Remember that story? And what happens to that one guest who was invited not because they were worthy, not because they were on the original guest list, but because the king was being gracious, and when they were invited, they refused to celebrate. They refused to put on the clothes the king had to offer them. And we are told that guest is then kicked out where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. Sound familiar? This reminds me of a movie that was out several years ago called Finding Nemo. You may have seen it. It's about this little clownfish that gets lost from his father and this big adventure. And in the midst of this movie, this little Nemo meets another fish named Dory. And throughout the movie, their interaction, finally there's one scene in the movie where Dory is trapped in a big fishing net along with all these other fish. And she cries out, and Nemo and his father hears the cries, and they go up to see what the problem is. And there Dory is, along with these other fish, being drawn up out of the ocean into the fishing boat. Well, Nemo has learned how to get out of such a situation. And he tells Dory and all the other fish, swim down. Swim down. And you see the scene as the fish begin to swim down, back down into the bottom of the ocean. And the boat begins to tip. And finally, as they begin to rise up out of the water, because of their fighting against the net, they finally pull the net back down. It breaks the boom the net is on, and the fish are released. And everyone is saved. Well, brothers and sisters in Christ, in the kingdom of God, it's just the opposite. When we fight against the kingdom of God, we are excluding ourselves from God. You see, God so loves us that God is willing to allow us to excuse ourselves, to not be captured in the net, to fight against it, to turn away from God. And it is in that we experience judgment. But the judgment isn't God's. The judgment is ours. Our unwillingness to be with those other people, those other fish, those ones that we don't think are qualified or worthy to be loved. You see, it is our own self-righteousness that keeps us from putting on the clothes of Christ. It keeps us from accepting God's love for us and for the other. You see, the kingdom of God takes us all in. The kingdom of God is greater than our own actions, our own thoughts. But if we refuse to forgive, when we refuse to love the other, when we refuse to be in the same place with those that we deem as unworthy, we cast ourselves out of the kingdom. Remember what Jesus says, if you're not willing to forgive the sins of others, your sins aren't forgiven. It's not that God doesn't forgive us. It's that we don't experience that forgiveness because we refuse, we exclude ourselves, we judge ourselves as being more right, more righteous, more good than the other. And they don't deserve us. Jesus rarely has trouble with people that the world saw as wicked. The ones Jesus had problems with were the ones who thought they were righteous, who thought they deserved God's love, those who thought God should love them for what they have done. That's not the way of the kingdom. The way of the kingdom is to trust that God's kingdom will capture us, to allow God's love to overwhelm us, to live in that kingdom and to receive, to accept, to love the others caught up in the net, to realize our righteousness is the righteousness of Jesus, not our own, that we do not deserve it or earn it, we simply respond to it by celebrating the other fish in the net, to realize that we're all simply invited guests and that we are to put on the clothes of Christ and there find our righteousness. Brothers and sisters in Christ, God's kingdom captures us all. But we need to be sure that we don't put up barriers from living into that kingdom. That we don't think ourselves more righteous because of the things we do or don't do. We need instead to celebrate that God's kingdom is so vast it captures us all. That we're all invited and loved in the kingdom. Let us not be like that older brother who refuses to go in because that other person is there. Let us instead put on the wedding clothes of Christ and joy in the celebration and the party that has no end. And find our righteousness, not in ourselves, but in the one who died for us on the cross, the one who forgave us our sins, the one that so loved the world, the one that has captured us in God's net. Live into that promise, beloved of God. Remember where your righteousness comes from and celebrate together the kingdom of God. Amen.
Story, how mercy can reach. all the ones I love, loving my Jesus. When all is said and done, when my last song's been sung, stand face to face with the one who gave all for me. May all I have to show be all that mattered most, making your great name known. This be my only legacy, loving my my heart is to see all the ones I love, all the ones I love, loving my Jesus.
Now is a time in our service that we are able to lift up before God our concerns, our praises, our very lives. At the end of each petition, I will say, Lord of the journey, I invite you to respond, walk with us. Let us pray. God of all creation, God whose desire it is that the whole world would be brought back under God's authority, we lift our voices to you, O God. We lift how oftentimes we fight against your kingdom. At times we don't believe that we are worthy to be loved by you. At other times we believe others are not worthy. But today you remind us that your net catches all of us, and our call is to respond to your loving care in such a way that it may reflect your love to others, and that we may live in the freedom of knowing that we are loved completely by you. Help us, O God, when we fight against your kingdom, against your love. May you continue to overwhelm us with your presence. May your peace surround us and fill us. And may we realize your desire for us and for the world to be loved, to be restored, to be redeemed. Lord of the journey, walk with us. This day, O God, as we end our summer season, as we look toward the fall, we lift up to you, O God, all those who have lost their lives these past several months to this virus that has affected so many across the world. Today, O God, we grieve. We grieve the loss. We grieve families that weren't able to say adequately goodbye to their loved ones because they were isolated. We pray, O God, for all those healthcare workers and first responders who cared for the most vulnerable among us. We grieve, O God. We grieve as a world. We grieve as a nation. We grieve as a community. We grieve as individuals. Lives have been lost. And we mourn that reality today. Give us your peace, O God, and allow us to remember your vast net that gathers us all in to your kingdom. We pray, O God, this day for this world. We pray for healing. We pray for peace. We pray for wisdom. Lord of the journey,
walk with us. We pray, O God, for this community as we move into the fall season. We continue to pray your wisdom upon the Corona Task Force as it makes decisions about how we are to come together as a community, as our council works with each other to provide a safe place for all to worship, to gather, to be community. We pray, O God, for the needs of this community. We lift up to you, Ted, as he continues to recover from his leg injury, and for Roger and the family as they continue to grieve Linda's death. We pray for Jeff, Glenn's brother. Pray for healing for him. We pray for those who are awaiting test results. We pray for those who are themselves isolated, either in care facilities or in their own homes. We pray for families that long to be together. We pray, O God, this time for schools as they're looking how to reopen. We pray for teachers and those that work in the cafeteria, bus drivers, custodians, parents, students. As difficult decisions are made and uncertainty surrounds all our decisions, be with school board superintendents and principals and others who are making critical decisions for our community and for our children. And we lift up to you, O God, those things that weigh heavy upon our hearts, those things that we want to place in your care, that we may experience your peace and wisdom. We lift them up to you, O God, aloud or silently in our hearts at this time. Lord of the journey, walk with us. Continue to move us forward, O God, as your people of hope, your people of the kingdom. We know that you will be with us in the days and weeks and months ahead. May we continue to look to you for support, for care, and may we continue to be the community you have called us to be, whether that's in our own homes, or when we are able to gather together in larger groups. Bless us and continue to strengthen us, O God, and reassure us that we have been caught in your love and being brought into your kingdom. We pray all this in your Son's name. Amen. I invite you now to join with me as we pray together our Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Again, I want to thank you as a community for your generosity. Because Hope gives generously, we continue to care and serve one another. If you would like to give online, you may see up on the screen the way to give through our website, or you can continue to drop off your giving or use the mail. Thank you again for your generosity. Because Hope gives, we can serve in Jesus' name. Now I invite you to hear the benediction, God sending. Now may you be confident that you have been caught in the net of God's love. May we work together so that all may experience the saving grace and love of God. May we see in each other your presence. And may we leave this worship with a sense of confidence, of being loved, restored, and redeemed by you. And may we share that good news, that promise, with all those we meet. Amen.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my Lord, open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy.
Go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Have a blessed week, and thank you for worshiping with us this morning.